I'm going to talk about what is becoming a more complex topic, and I would argue that it's actually not becoming more complex. I think we're actually finally unpacking gender a little bit more fully. That has actually been an issue for millennia across many cultures and societies. I like using cartoons when I can because I am a millennial, and this is where I learned a lot of lessons. So I think it's important to really kind of get to our notions. We always hear of like men are from Mars, women are from Venus. We always create these artificial binaries around what is gender. And I would argue you could even go so far farther as to say like only people from Mars can love people from Venus, and only people from Venus can love people from Mars, and we know that's not true as well. We are on Earth. Things are much more complicated here. Things are a little bit more diverse, and I'm really going to try and get beyond what I'm going to call binary bullshit. So moving on to our next cartoon. I like using this diagram, the gender unicorn. People have heard about this probably at some point if they've ever been exposed to anything around gender diversity. I'm going to provide a few definitions here since some things might be new to folks. So gender identity, that is your internal understanding of yourself. It does not fit necessarily on a feminine, masculine, or male, female, man, woman binary. You can actually have multiple layers to this. Gender expression is how you use your social or cultural upbringing to cue that. I'm wearing a three-piece suit, but I also have a lot of rings like Liberace. So I'm borrowing from a lot of different cues within my own culture. Sex assigned at birth, this is the one we're often most stuck on, and this is the one that we're taught, at least within medicine. We're not taught anything else, to be perfectly honest. It's boy, it's a girl, that's about it. We know that's also not true. We know there's a significant diversity in how we assign sex as soon as somebody is born or even before they're born, and I'll touch on that later. And then, of course, around sexual attraction or sexual orientation, there is physically attracted to, and then there's also emotional attraction. These don't always align for some folks, so I think it's important to really recognize this is complicating, I hope, everything that you were ever raised with, since everything was a little flat in our society. I would like to pause and let people just think, where do you fit in any of these categories? Where do you fit in any of these lines? Kind of contemplate that. Think about that. Think about how you navigate your world, your day-to-day living, as it relates to any of these categories. Because I guarantee you, a lot of my patients who are trans or gender diverse think about this constantly. They have to think about this every time they see a doctor. They have to think about this every time they choose to go outside. How are they going to dress? How are they going to present themselves? How are people going to react to any way they look, no matter how true their gender identity is to themselves? So things to keep in mind. I've given a few talks around how to provide care for trans individuals. I've been asked to do it in under 8 minutes, which I think is mind-boggling, to try and explain all of trans and gender-diverse health within 8 minutes. So I often turn to what I would describe as a presidential forum at this point. I ask questions on Twitter. I don't advocate doing foreign policy this way, but I like asking questions this way. So I asked everybody, like, hey, what do you want to know as a provider? What would you share as a lesson? This is Dr. Manning's lesson. Don't act like my truth is a novelty. Relax, let's be authentic together. That's what a trans woman patient told me once when I was trying too hard. Her advice changed the way I care for and interact with trans and non-binary people. Thanks for all you do, Carl. Fist bump. It's always nice to get a fist bump from Dr. Manning. For those who don't know, Dr. Manning is the 270th full professor in academic medicine in the US out of 38,000 full professors. So she's pretty badass. So when she's sharing this kind of advice, what you need to recognize is that I said earlier that trans individuals and gender diverse individuals are always thinking about their gender and how they interact with people, especially in healthcare. It's important to recognize that that might be how they're thinking. That's not how you need to necessarily respond. So in healthcare, people come to us for a lot of different reasons. This could simply be a cold. I don't need to really be focused on your gender at that moment. And that's the same for every interaction I advocate when people are talking to transgender and gender diverse folks. Their gender, they're going to share it with you when they need to. You shouldn't be so focused on it. And you shouldn't be trying to figure out who belongs in the right restroom. That's another issue that we'll get to. Next piece of advice comes from the remarkable Jessica Hallam. I say that because she officiated my wedding, but also because she's also what I would describe, and she would really describe as kind of like an old school lesbian in terms of her approach to society. Becoming affirming and confident of how to be a great doctor to trans people is going to make you a better doctor to other patients because gender roles and expression and expectations make an impact on all of us. This first one I really want you to think about. How your identification, maybe if you were always told you were a man, always told you were a woman, and how society has certain expectations for you. People say women belong in the kitchen. people say men should be out there doing heavy labor, things like that. I was raised in a very masculine household that was military, very much. My father was a lumberjack, and his name was Butch. He was in a biker gang. These kind of things, these are the expectations that are laid on us that don't always fit, and those expectations can create a lot of stress. And that kind of stress actually does get internalized and leads to significant health disparities seen in not only trans and gender diverse folks, but also in everybody. I have a number of patients, cisgender, straight white men, who are coming to me who cannot even begin to express their emotions because society never taught them that they could, that they were allowed to, or even how to do that when they needed to. So recognize that gender is affecting all of us. The next big part here, I think is really important, is transgender health must be rooted in fighting sexism and patriarchy and the negative roles they've played in all of our lives. Transgender affirmation is rooted in freedom from the patriarchy and sexism. Learning that helps us all. Burn it down. I'm telling you, just burn it all down. The way our society has really set up issues around sex and gender, around attraction and relationships, has been too binary and too restrictive. I'm stuck, unfortunately, in this little circle. Normally, I'm stuck in a box, and that's really restrictive in terms of how you can navigate your day-to-day life. Next one is really a little bit more next level from Dr. Rachel Jackson. Trans people are not just patients, but also colleagues. Acknowledge that they exist, work with them, recruit them, cite their publications. This is also for us in academics and in healthcare. Recognize that too often do we do work on populations rather than with populations. We don't often invite the people we're studying into the process, and that's a big mistake. We try and do a little bit better within our own Center for Transgender Medicine and Surgery here by ensuring that we have patient navigators who are part of the community, who are ones really walking our patients through every step of the process. We're looking to hire new folks as well. For those who are interested, Dr. Jackson, and she's given me permission, is also an out trans woman, also on the job market. So something to keep in mind. And the reason that's really important, too, is that it's not always easy to actually be out. In the U.S., there are only about 24 states that provide explicit protections around gender identity, gender expression, and so forth. 26 states and 3 territories, don't forget that we're a colonial power, we have territories, do not provide any guarantee of protection if you are discriminated against. There are certain states even I could be hired where I could be fired by bringing my husband to a holiday party. So I think it's really important to recognize that we are not providing protections around this diversity that truly does exist every day. And the last one kind of gets a little bit to more the work I do and work that others are doing in the community. Trauma is not a sustainable energy source for justice work. Trauma motivates a lot of what people do, and we've heard a lot of examples so far where something bad happened that motivated people to change because they were angry, they were frustrated, it was a traumatic experience. Great way to start a movement, not a great way to sustain it. People burn out. We've heard many cases where people get burned out, have to leave a movement. We've heard of people having premature health conditions. We know of people having heart attacks at young ages because of the stress that's associated with trying to sustain a movement like this. It's not possible. I do give these talks a lot. It's really uncomfortable as an introvert to give a lot of talks, but I want to make sure people are thinking about this kind of stuff. And the reason I do bring this up is a number of traumatic experiences where I've had doctors walk out on me when I've come out to them, and I've had colleagues actually in my own medical school say I didn't belong there. And we've had society at large, we've had administrators, we've had folks in positions of power really say, this is not real work. This is not evidence-based, and I would argue that that's not the case. And thankfully, we have a large group here who really try and do something about that. This is actually a picture taken at MGH when I was a fellow at Brigham, where we were trying to address the concern around potential removal of certain words in terms of grants, in terms of doing any kind of work that could affect LGBTQ folks. The benefit of this kind of work is that if I ever feel burned out, I can take a breath. The way a choir actually sustains a note is not that everybody's holding the note for the entire time, it's that people are taking strategic breaths and the choir carries the rest of the note. And that's the same way we do this kind of work. I actually went to, as I mentioned, Johns Hopkins for medical school. When I first got there, I had a classmate say they let in too many gay people. There's two of us in a class of 120. We were the only two out at that time across all 4 classes. There were too many of us. There were two of us. That's very discouraging. And you can only imagine as myself, as a white cisgender man who really is only one identity away from being the man, if people don't think I belong, think about how it is for our gender diverse individuals in any part of society in terms of how they're even entering healthcare. I think Dr. Rachel Jackson, as I mentioned earlier, is a remarkable hero and leader just for the sake of being so powerful to actually pursue healthcare, which is not the most welcoming environment for training. But also at this time, not only did my classmates give me grief, when I started doing this work in medical school, recognizing that we weren't getting the education, that I'm really trying to address what's going on in LGBTQ health disparities and then discussing interventions, the dean of the curriculum actually pulled me aside after a class and said this word. He said, my work was superficial. And I cannot tell you, the fact that this is on a slide at a TED Talk 10 years later tells you I have still carrying that. So the work is not superficial. We have a number of curricula now within medical schools that are focused on what we describe as genes to society. This is the social work, this is the cultural work that is affecting everything down to genes. We know that discrimination, we know that experiences of stigma can get encoded within our own genes and passed on to next generations. So this is not superficial. And this is really happening right now. This is where the current administration tried to define sex as strictly binary. The agency's proposed definition would define sex as either male or female, unchangeable, and determined by the genitals that a person is born with. Anybody who's involved with the birthing process can tell you that is not as straightforward as it sounds. Anybody who does any genetics knows this is not the right way we do this. We know that, yes, most people fit into categories of man and woman, but there's a significant diversity between those two. And these are just a few of the diagnoses that actually create a diversity of gender and sexual development in terms of what we actually see when somebody is born or even later in life. Somebody could be completely have a physiological female presentation, but later in life we discover they actually have XY chromosomes. So recognize there is significant diversity and that this policy is not evidence-based. This is an affront to science and medicine, I would say. And it goes so far then as to proposing new protections to healthcare professionals to discriminate. So under the current administration, Director Severino is saying laws protecting religious freedom and conscious rights are just empty words on paper if they aren't enforced. Okay, we'll stop. That's okay. No one should be forced to choose between helping sick people and living by one's deepest moral and religious convictions. I would argue if you have moral religious convictions against helping sick people, you're in the wrong profession. This needs to stop. So I'm really arguing that I kind of blew up gender a little bit for you, but I also want you to recognize that things are actively happening right now to silence this work and to protect people who are deliberately harming our patients. We at Center for Transgender Medicine and Surgery here at Boston Medical Center, we've been part of a number of public campaigns. This was part of that one around definitions. We're doing our best to not be erased, and I'm really hoping you can help us do the same. There is a significant diversity out there, and I think medicine has long recognized it, and we're doing better by it. Help us make sure that everybody else is as well. So, thank you.